Hello and welcome, I'm James Murphy, and today we're talking about how to exponentiate efficiently. Spoiler alert, this video was inspired by Project Euler's problem number 122. Suppose for a moment that we don't have access to the built-in exponentiation operator or any math library that's going to do it for us. Put yourself in the position of someone who might be trying to write one of those libraries. This is the kind of thing that you might have to think about if you were writing a programming language or a compiler for a programming language. Here I have the most obvious way you could possibly implement raising something to the 15th power. Namely, just start with the variable and multiply it by itself 14 more times. Assuming I didn't make a typo, if you count the number of stars, you'll see that this requires 14 multiplications. But you can actually compute x to the 15th power using far fewer. The first clever thing that you might think to do is to use the binary expansion of the number 15. As we can see from the binary representation, 15 requires 4 powers of 2, 1, 2, 4, and 8. We can compute those by repeatedly squaring. I compute x squared is x times x, then x to the fourth is x squared times x squared, then x to the eighth is x to the fourth times x to the fourth. Then to get x to the 15th power, I just read off the binary expansion. I need an x to the 8th, I need an x to the 4th, I need an x squared, and I need an x. This allows me to compute x to the 15th power in only 6 multiplications. Additionally, 15 isn't really special here. I could have done the same thing using basically any positive integer. First, write it in binary, compute all the powers of 2 that I need by repeatedly squaring, and then put those powers of 2 together according to the number's binary expansion to get the number. The number of multiplications needed for this method scales approximately logarithmically with the size of this number 15. This is much better than the linear number of multiplications that we used in the naive method. Okay, so what's the minimum number of multiplications that I could possibly get away with? Well, for 15, here's the answer. You compute x squared, and then x cubed, and then x to the 6th, then 12th, then the 15th. However, unlike the binary example, there's no clear pattern as to how I got these numbers. Well, it turns out this is a very hard problem. The best algorithms so far are essentially try every possible sequence of numbers and see which ones give you the least multiplications. There are certainly some tricks that have been found that allow you to rule out some bad guesses and things like that, but in general, this is still an exponential time problem. No one really knows how to do any better. You might think this is silly. When does anyone raise something to the 15th power? But people really do care about this, even in real life. Look what happens when I put this example into Compiler Explorer. On the left, I write x times x times x 15 times. On the right, you can see both for GCC and Clang that each of these assembly outputs only uses 6 multiplications. This isn't a coincidence. The people who wrote those compilers cared about this problem. Before we dive into the code to try to find these numbers, first, let's note that we can represent this whole computation process just with a string of numbers. The numbers are just the powers and the order that I compute them in. So for the minimal example, I compute x to the 1, then x squared, then cubed, then to the 6th, then 12th, then 15th. As you might guess, I'm going to be storing these numbers in a tuple. We will then successively try all the possibilities. What can we make in one multiplication, in two multiplications, in three multiplications, and so on? Because in the process of computing the most efficient way to exponentiate for some power, I'll also compute a whole bunch of other powers. I'm going to represent and store all the information that I compute during the algorithm. I will store all that information inside a class, which I can then ask to compute more and more and more until it finds the numbers that I'm looking for. I'll start with an initial chain of just 1, meaning x to the first power. I don't need to do any computations to get x to the first power. This map will keep track of, for each number, what is a minimal length chain that ends up at that number. So when I plug in 15, I should get this chain, or at least one that's the same length. Every time I multiply n plus 1 things together, I first multiply n things together, so I know that when I compute the next step of the algorithm, I'm going to use the answers from the previous step. For that reason, I'll use this variable cached chains to store the answers from the previous step. The step variable tells me what step of the algorithm I'm in, how many multiplications am I using. And the step limit just tells me not to go too far so I don't run out of memory. Computing a single step is definitely the hard part of the algorithm. First, I check that I haven't stepped too far, and then I increase the step count. I iterate through all the chains of one less length, and for each of them, I need to compute what are all the new chains of one more length that I can make from them. This corresponds to multiplying two smaller powers that we've already computed. For instance, for this chain, I could add on an 18 by using 6 and 12, or a 21 by using 6 and 15. You might think that for a given chain, in order to extend it, I need to try all possible pairs of elements in the chain. But it turns out that for exponents smaller than this, it's always okay to assume that one of the numbers is the largest number in the list. It is by no means obvious that assuming this will still give you the right answer. I'm not going to even try to explain why this is allowed, but I will link to a good starting point, a research paper that you can read if you want to look into it. Okay, so I will always assume that one of the two powers that I'm using is the biggest one. That is the last thing in the list. For the other one, I just try all the other things in the list. Then I compute the exponent that I get by using those two smaller exponents. I make a new chain that has now one more thing on the end of it, and then I add that to my set of newly computed chains. Now the important part. If this is the first time I have ever seen this exponent, then I set this chain as the minimal chain for that exponent. I use the built-in dictionary method setDefault to do this. What setDefault does is, if a key already exists in a dictionary, it does nothing, but if it doesn't exist in the dictionary, then it sets the value. This ensures that each number is linked to the first chain that produces that number. Subsequent or longer chains will not overwrite this value. The last thing that we need to do is set all the chains that we just computed to be the new cache for the next step. Then we make a little helper function which will facilitate finding the answer for a specific exponent. Basically, we just keep computing longer and longer chains until the set default finally finds a chain that is able to produce the desired number. Then to find a chain for a specific exponent, we just step until it's computed and then return it. If for some reason we only cared about the number of multiplications and not the actual chain that tells us how to get there, then we can just note that the number of multiplications is one less than the length of the chain. So here's how you would put it together to solve the Project Euler question, which asks us to compute the sum of the first 300 answers. I'll time my answer to make sure it doesn't take more than 1 minute. I set the end that I'm looking for as the number 300. Then I create an instance of my class. Just for my benefit, I want to print out all of the chains, and then for Project Euler, I'll just go ahead and sum up the answers. Let's see how it goes. Okay, it looks like we finished with an answer of 2593 in 51 seconds. Scrolling up towards the top here, we do see that it found the same answer that I mentioned before for 15, 1, 2, 3, 6, 12, 15. Also notice that it's not a monotonic function. Sometimes a bigger exponent can take less multiplications. The last thing that I want to mention is that although we did this problem for multiplication of just integers, we can actually say the exact same thing of multiplication of any kind of objects. As long as I know what it means to multiply a thing by itself, I can make sense of exponentiating something or raising it to an integer power. This allows the answer to be useful in a more general context beyond just what you would get for integers. For integers, after all, when's the last time you ever raised something to a power other than 2, 3, or maybe 4? Imagine for a moment that x is not an integer, but a 1 million by 1 million matrix. Saving even just one multiplication might be meaningful when you have a problem this large. I also want to point out that there are many matrix models that are useful in applications. You start out with a vector and then repeatedly multiply by a matrix to get the next state in the model. That means if you want to know what happens 1,000 time steps later in the future, that's equivalent to multiplying by the matrix to the power 1,000. This is another place where taking a big power of an object comes up. Well, that's all I've got on this topic. If you enjoyed the video, please consider subscribing and telling your friends. And as always, don't forget to slap that like button an odd number of times.